our end. So we are recording the whole session at our end, and this recording would be available to all of you. It will be published as a webinar. It will be published on the YouTube channel. So you really don't need to worry about any of that. Great. Does it answer you, Prabhu? Thanks. Thank you so much. Fantastic. So let me just quickly share my screen. You need to give me a minute. If you can give me a quick yes on the chat, if you're able to see the screen. Thank you so much. Fantastic. So I think let's just quickly, you know, get rolling, and please make sure that you keep on typing out your questions, and we'll take them at a particular interval. Fantastic. So I think we're going to start off with absolute basics. You know, what really is data science? You know, why you should learn more and more data sciences? What's the use case for all of you kind of, you know, taking up some of this or taking active interest in this particular thing? How can GreyAtom truly, you know, help you? And what GreyAtom truly is, and what are the next steps? So we just want to touch upon all of this in a very, very, you know, quick kind of a thing. So just wanted to make sure what data science is, and we all have the same understanding about data sciences. Well, I think this is a very simple visualization. And what we are trying to tell over here is that, say, a company like Ford started off, you know, really long time back, hundreds of years ago. But in 1960s, 1970s, it started making its own CRM, its own ERP, and they did it all by themselves. By 1980s, they had realized that that's not their core strength. They thought, let's give it to TCS, let's give it to Infosys, and all those kinds of companies, and they will just focus on manufacturing vehicles. They had so much data in all their systems that they discovered that by the 1990s, there were companies which were, you know, core focused analytics companies. So not really 90s, but early 2000. So you had companies like Mu Sigma, Fractal, and tons of companies, you know, which have mushroomed up off late and over the last 20 years. So they thought that these companies are really good with analyzing my data and giving me insight. So we started off with people doing their own stuff, outsourcing it. So we had the whole BPO kind of a revolution, the IT revolution. And then we had the whole KPO business coming in, you know, the Mu Sigmas and Fractals and a lot of these companies that really grew and are still growing strength to strength. There were certain companies in them which realized that, you know, I think this is something that is too core for my business to be outsourced. So like someone like banks, ICICI, HDFC, Barclays, they said that this is like, you know, my data. Why should I give it to someone so that they can give me the insight back? This is my data. I better act on it. So I think we have seen the whole journey from doing everything in-house, offshoring it as services, and trying to again bring it back partly or completely as in-house captives. So the productization of data and data product. So that's what we are truly seeing. And extending this journey even, you know, above. So these are all big companies, you know, TCS, Ford, Barclays. But even a small company, even I would not say a small company, but all companies of all sizes. So data science is not something that you do because you got big. Data science is something that you do at all sizes. So if you're a Pepperfry, if you're a small startup that's based out of Bangalore, which is doing really cutting edge, interesting stuff, you still need data sciences to differentiate yourself. So now data science is being adopted by all the people. So the jobs that are really getting created are, of course, the TCS and Infosys and Accenture, Capgemini, they are creating tons of jobs in the data sciences space. But it is also the smaller companies, the startups, which are having those, you know, one vacancy, two vacancy kind of thing. And these are like in, you know, hordes. So you have like 10,000 startups that are based in NCR, another 6,000 which are in Mumbai, another 12,000 that are there in Bangalore. And these are the people that are going to, you know, create the next 100,000 jobs for all the data sciences. So that's the journey. That's, you know, that's what we have been seeing. If you try and look at what data sciences is, you're going to see a lot of these Venn diagrams. So yeah, I think, and it's always debatable. So I think the best way to understand what data sciences truly is basically to get into examples. So let's just look at maybe a couple of examples. There are tons of them over here, but let's look at a couple of examples. So here we had someone, you know, you basically had a supermarket that's based out of US, and they came to a conclusion that people who buy diapers, they also buy beers, or vice versa. People who buy beers, they also buy diapers. So when they did a little bit of soul searching and digging deep, they really understood that these are actually young fathers who have come to the supermarket to just pick up, you know, diapers, and beer being very socially acceptable, they just want to take a crate of a beer. So how do you, what's the insight over here? The insight probably over here is that in the layout of that particular mall, of that supermarket, why don't you keep beer and diaper something very close to each other? Fantastic. So I think Rahul, I think, has, you know, pinpointed that, and it's a Walmart kind of a use case. So this is something that is, you know, a result of an outcome of what we call as a market basket analysis, some sort of an association rules. So we have been doing this for some years now, and you know, this is something that data science typically affords you. All of us use Facebook, and there are some of these, you know, feed that we see, and your feed is your feed, and it is something very personal. So depending on what you click, you get to see more and more of the same thing. So that's again data sciences. Book My Show, Uber. It's again one of those cross-sell kind of thing. If you book something, then maybe 2 hours before that particular event, they know where you stay, they know where the event is, so they'll just tell you, why don't you use this particular coupon and take the Uber. So again, that's something that has resulted in a big upside from a bottom line perspective for Uber. And of course, Book My Show has some sort of a revenue sharing agreement with them. Very interesting case study. I think this is something, just I'm quoting, you know, something in the Indian context, but there have been tons of these alliances globally. Amazon.com, Amazon Prime, Netflix, all these are like superb examples of recommender systems, you know, based on the genre of the movies, episodes, webisodes, whatever you see, you get to see more of the same. It's recommendation, and that's, you know, is powered behind, like people who bought this also bought that. These two, three things were bought together. So these are all examples of recommender system. Spellcheck again has been there for now, you know, ages. Then we have the WhatsApp predict. I mean, this is more of a, you know, a Google predictive typing, but if you keep on typing certain things, it will keep on showing you the same thing again and again. It learns from what you do. And this is all extending to even the Siri and the Cortana and, you know, all the things that you keep on talking about. Fair enough. So I think these are some of the, you know, just to get a drift. So this is what data science truly is. If you're a data science professional, you will be building these applications. This is something that you're seeing over here is, you know, Yatra.com, Haptic. These are all Indian companies. These are all the brands that you might be aware of from an Indian context. And CleverTap. So CleverTap is essentially Google Analytics for mobile apps. Let's just put it very simply. And they have, you know, interfaces for web apps, so on and so forth. So Yatra is solving a very interesting problem. They're solving many problems. But one of the problems that they're solving is if you're traveling and if you put a search query, which is basically two adults, two children, and Mumbai to, Sydney. Then I think what Yatra typically wants to understand is if you're two adults and two children, most likely it is a family. It is starting from Mumbai, so most likely it is an Indian family. And they really won't mind a hopping flight as long as the prices are really rock bottom. You really want to optimize for the prices. So how should the search results be engineered in case of this query versus if you have like a query Mumbai to Delhi, 7 p.m. flight, Mumbai to Delhi. So most likely it's a solo traveler, a business traveler. So how do you want to engineer the search results? You really don't want a Mumbai, Jaipur, Delhi flight. You want a Mumbai to Delhi direct flight. So depending, you know, trying to understand what kind of users you have and prioritizing the search results. So these are actual problems that OTAs, online travel agents like Yatra.com are solving. Very interesting use case. And we really have access to some of these. And what we mean by we have access to this is like in some of the previous batches that I've graduated, people have used and worked on Haptic data sets. People have worked on CleverTap data sets and they have done projects based on some of these data sets. So good. Yeah, so we have Ashish. I think my voice is breaking. Is it okay now? Do I need to take the mic even more closer? Is it breaking for all of you or is it only breaking for a few participants? Okay, so we are good. Everyone can hear me? Okay, fantastic. So, okay, resuming back. So I think, you know, why should we really, you know, learn data sciences? So I'll again, you know, maybe spend another 5 minutes over here. So, And more than taking through the deck and everything, it shows a macro picture, what is really happening at a very high level. But let's just look at something that is very specific and focused to the Indian context. So I think there is demand, and let's just look at why there is demand. Why there is demand? So let me give you a very specific example. There is a company which is based out of Mumbai, very much based out of Andhra to be very precise. So without naming them, I'll tell you that they are essentially competing with some of the Atlassian products, Confluence and Jira. So Confluence and Jira and Atlassian is a very established stack. So an Indian company is competing at a global scale. Of course, they are pricing themselves extremely aggressively, and they have customer base which is established and local. However, they also realize that they really, really need to pump in really quality features into their product, because the price as a differentiator is not going to probably serve them in the longer run. So it's a 200 people outfit, and they want to train all 200 people. It's a 200 people company, and they want to train all 200 people. So they have engineers who are software engineers who understand their domain, who understand their business. Now they just want to upskill them. So that's a real, real thing. That's a real, real thing. So someone like an online travel agent. So they have like 1200 call center agents who are on their particular payroll, and they are currently doing a lot of things like, cancellations, refunds, bookings, online, manual process, because it looks very seamless to us when you're using Yatra.com. But sometimes we have a lot of delays, especially international travel. So reconciling the visas, making sure everything is in place, we have the insurance. So there are so many of these steps. And it's a very, manual process at this point in time. Yatra is interested in optimizing this process. Make My Trip is interested in optimizing this process. All the people, all the participants are basically trying to search for that competitive edge by automating a lot of these things. So their attempt is not to, kill jobs. Their attempt is to basically be more and more competitive in the market. So that's where I think a lot of demand is coming from. Because a lot of these new age agile companies, they're innovating really, really very much on fly, and they're getting a lot of results done faster. So there is like superb demand that's, in this particular place. Demand is, of course, soaring. Very important point. Let's just spend half a minute over here. This is something that is core to the business. It is not something that people are doing like a reporting layer or as a matter of fact or as an afterthought. This is something that people are building within their product. So if you are a pepper fry, so you don't want to just be doing a very simple kind of a recommendation that you bought a mattress, let me suggest a pillow or some sort of a, pillow cover. I think they really want to be able to think slightly broader. If you're trying to look at a mattress, maybe you're looking at the whole bedroom set, or maybe you're looking at a larger service, which is renovating your whole house. How can you cater to very interesting demands, some customer requirements? And this is something that, a pepper fry is never going to give it to an offshoring unit. They might do a few hackathons here and there, but they are going to keep this inside because it is their proprietary thing, and they really want to be differentiating based on that. I think these are the articles, they keep on coming every now and then. We can read them, but they really, really need to take them with a pinch of salt. The numbers can tend to be really, really exaggerated. They only reinforce a point that there is a demand-supply mismatch. That's the whole point. Quickly, we'll touch upon a few points. I think a lot of companies which are doing very interesting things over here. So, CC Avenues are doing it for, fraud detection. Indus Valley Partners is a very fine company based out of Mumbai. So they are, doing a lot of internal initiatives to rekindle a lot of machine learning initiatives and, trying to innovate, improvise, so on and so forth. So I think we spoke about all of this at some point in time. I hope you kind of, got the gist. Do we have any questions so far? If you have any questions, just make sure you keep on, typing them out in the chat window, and we'll be more than happy to take them at some point in time. Fantastic. Getting back, I think this is one of the questions that I get asked very, very frequently. What's the career track? What's the career path for a data science professional? So is it like, so this question typically comes from a lot of IT companies that we have. The IT companies have a very nicely defined 14 level, 17 level kind of a hierarchy, where you start off as an analyst programmer, band one, B2, AP2, B2, AP1, all those kind of things. Then you go on to become an IT analyst. So I think people are searching for and essentially looking for a similar kind of a career path with respect to data sciences. So unfortunately, none exists. It's not something that is hard and very clearly documented and standardized across companies. So typically, I think you can look forward to career track, which is twofold. You can start off as in a data engineering track, or you can start off in an analyst track. So what I mean by data engineering is where you're doing a lot of data infrastructure and a lot of big data stuff, where you're enabling a lot of other teams to do stuff. So I think if you're going to put some sort of a streaming architecture, some sort of a high velocity, high volume kind of a thing, so that's more of a data engineering track. And the second thing is where you are actually leveraging that data and building something and solving some of the business problems that the business is facing. So you're more and more solving the business problem. You're not doing really a lot of data engineering, but you're just using and leveraging the data to do a lot of these things. Both of them are technical. Data engineering is a lot more hardcore engineering. If you're on the data engineering side, you need to have good appreciation of what is happening in the analyst side. And if you're at the analyst side, you better have a lot of appreciation on the engineering side. So again, one really practical tip, and this is something much beyond this, where the market is truly full of a lot of people who have generic skills. The market is full of people who have a lot of generic skills. So if you think that you're going to do like a 15-day course, 1-month course, and you're going to be like a data scientist and you're going to land your next job, I think that's truly not going to happen. That is truly, truly, truly not going to happen. You can finish the content and the curriculum in 1 month, but I think it is a practice that is truly going to differentiate you, and you really need to be able to build profiles. So how do you really get a job? How do you really get a job in data sciences, and what are the reasons where people have successfully pivoted their careers and joined organizations? So there are broadly 2 to 3 ways. I'll just quickly outline them. One is you need to have a very strong portfolio. By portfolio, we mean is that you have a very strong social presence in terms of GitHub, in terms of some sort of a blogging history where you have articulated your thoughts very, very clearly. Communication plays a very, very critical role. The second thing is you come across very strongly in the hiring process. So the hiring process can typically be a hiring challenge where companies are more and more interested in asking you, can you solve my problem? And they give you the problem, and if you solve it, they are suddenly interested in you. Or the second thing is they give you some sort of an aptitude test. And the aptitude test is more and more relevant at an entry level. And at an entry level, I think the aptitude test will essentially help filter out a lot of people, who are just good with maths and logic and communication skills, so on and so forth. So that is the thing. So you need to have a very strong portfolio. You need to come across very strongly in the hiring process. And I think that's where people are able to successfully, pivot their careers into data sciences. So these are some of the indicative list of companies who are, hiring. This is a very interesting number. You should check out Glassdoor. Glassdoor is a very popular site. Put the location as Mumbai or just India in general, and just put for data scientists and so on and so forth. You're going to find some number which is approximately like this. And I think from my first-hand insight, what I can tell you is that this number is slightly exaggerated. If you are starting off in data sciences, I think the appropriate salary that you should be offering, I think this is a question which is very tricky to answer, to be very honest, but I'm always being pushed to answer some of these questions, so I just make sure that I answer them upfront. If you're starting off in data sciences as a fresher, the typical salary that you should expect is somewhere in the range of 6 to 9, depending on how strongly you come across. If you're pivoting your career, and if you're in the bracket of say 0 to 3 years or 3 to 6 years, depending on what you've done so far and where your base salaries currently are, you should look at 30% hike from there on. And that's a real industry kind of a thing. All the astronomical numbers that you see anywhere else in print or on web are, I would say, slight exaggerations. We speak from first-hand experience. There are people who have done the program at GreyAtom and have graduated and successfully made transitions into different career tracks. Fantastic. Do we have any questions so far? So we have a question from Vikrant over here. Is this session specifically only for engineers or also for math stats graduate? I mean, data science is only for engineers, or maths, stats, grad can also opt for this track? I think that's a great question. Let me just quickly try and answer this. To make a career transition into data sciences, there are two very popular ways. One is if you have some sort of a background in engineering, and second is if you have some sort of a background in statistic. So I think if you have background in engineering, it is assumed that you've gone through maths 1, maths 2, maths 3, maths 4, and even maths 5 as per the Mumbai University curriculum. If you have gone through 12th standard maths, if you've gone through 12th standard maths, I would say you are very much in a reasonably strong position where you can make some sort of a career transition. We have seen people who have done BSc mathematics and who have made good inroads in this particular things. So I would say programming is a very essential skill. If you have a great amount of head start in programming, I think you're in a great position, great place. And I think you should be able to make very good progress with respect to data sciences. So I would place the skill that you have in programming. And what I mean by programming is programming. It is not C or Java or anything specific. If you have done any kind of programming at any point in time, it is going to be something very, very important. Does that answer your question? In case not, let me know. I'll take some of the few more questions. What are the skill sets that we need to be a data scientist? So this is Prabhu, and he's asking, what are the skill sets that we need to be a data scientist? So here is the thing. To make any serious inroads into become a data science professional, I would say the number one thing that you need to have is, I would say, some sort of a background in programming. It is very difficult to make a non-programmer programmer, then a programmer a data science professional. I think that's two hops, and that's like not an impossible journey, but it is very tough. There are people who have made it, but one journey is good at a time, and let's just do at that point in time. The second thing is, I would say, learnability. And what I mean by learnability is that if I give you some sort of an article, and if I ask you how does an air conditioner work? So, and if I tell you that the equation that powers the air conditioning is a thermodynamic law, and it is PV is equal to NRT. And how does that work? So I've given you the equation. Now I've given you the principle, and I've told you that there's a device called as air conditioner. Can you now help me explain mathematically how this thing works? So everything is in front of you. Nothing is like hidden. All the principles are in front of you. Can you now explain mathematically? So that just relies on your ability to open up Wikipedia, watch a few YouTube videos, and then explain and articulate. If you're able to learn stuff, if you're able to continuously learn stuff, I would say that is like a super skill. That is like a super skill that you need. So I think I would just say programming and learnability. I think if these two things are there, we are kind of, very much there. I'll quickly take the next question. We have, I'm a 2016 pass out mechanical engineer and want to pursue career in analytics. And this question is from Saurabh Nick Vade. I have no experience. Does my gap after graduation affect? I'm planning to start Python and SQL in Feb. So there are people who have done comp science, IT, and all the allied fields where the focus on programming is significantly higher when they are going through the curriculum. Nonetheless, if you have graduated from any other discipline in India, in engineering, whether it is civil or mechanical, you have definitely gone through some sort of a programming. You have definitely gone through some sort of a programming. So the skill that you're really looking for is programming. A person who has done comp science and IT has a more focused skill, possibly, in data science, data structures and algorithms. These are two subjects, data structures and algorithms. They have a more kind of a specific expertise that we would tend to believe. So they would probably have some amount of head start, but I think that is not a hindrance. If you're an engineer, I believe there is a very strong use case that you can make a very potent data science professional, provided you have affinity, liking for programming, some sort of a comfort with mathematics, and a very strong learnability. So I would definitely rate that higher. I think having a gap after graduation, here is like first-hand perspective. Guys, employers are like way too smart. Whether you're switching frequently or whether there's a gap for 2 years or anything, I think it really doesn't matter. What really matters is that that employer is going to give you a problem to solve. And if you are able to solve that problem, it doesn't matter. If you are civil, if you are production, if you are mechanical, if you are chemical, it really doesn't matter. I think if you're able to solve their problems, they are interested in you. I have come across the best people. I know someone from IIT Roorkee. He's done his civil, and he in fact won the prize for designing the whole railway station. One of the very smart and intelligent guys. He's doing exceptionally well when it comes to data sciences, because I think his basic aptitude in engineering, it's not about any of this. I think if you're able to solve some of this is fantastic. With respect to, I'm planning to start learning Python and SQL. So I think this is I'll take the larger question. How should I start my career path in data sciences? Should I take R? Should I take Python? Should I take SQL? Should I refresh my mathematics and all those questions? I think we really get a lot of these questions. So here's the thing. Each one of you, so all the people who are on this particular, who've logged in over here are all special, and they have their very specific ways of learning. So some of you learn by watching videos, some of you learn by reading, some of you learn by actually doing stuff. So I think you have to figure out what is your best way. Some people learn by looking at mathematics, some people looking at, doing programming. So that's essentially the thing. The generic set of skills that you essentially need are, you need one programming language. I have 20 reasons why you should choose Python over R, and more than happy to share some of them, because Python is a general purpose programming language. The adoption, the uptake for Python, and once you move to some production grade environment, you'll possibly be using some variant of Python or Python in general. So Python is definitely a good start that you can have. Specifically in Python, I would say learn how to do pandas and a lot of data massaging and data preprocessing, because 80% of the time you're going to do that. You are going to do a lot of preprocessing, and your skills in pandas and NumPy and processing data are going to take you like a really, really long way. So Python, I think, is a very good starting point at any point in time. Generally, it's a very good starting point. So I hope that answers your question. There is a question, how important is a MapReduce management of big data? Very specific pointed question. So this is by I Khubnani. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing the name accurately, but I would really want to answer this offline. Probably this is a very specific question, so I'm going to note it down. I'm going to have this chat saved anyways, but I'm just going to make a note of this. Just moving on to the next question. Is this session for someone who's already started his career in data science and knows little basics? I'm not sure how much you'll benefit from the session, definitely, but I think the program that we have at GreyAtom, that is something very much for people who are already doing some sort of a data science. So we have people in our program who are doing a lot of SaaS, marketing analytics, next best offer in banking, and they're doing it more from an offline processing data analytics perspective, and they're making that transition into data sciences. Well, nice to see you, Vikrant. I think the next question is about, what about domain knowledge? So we have Pankaj over here, and he has asked this question, what about domain knowledge? Domain knowledge really helps. Broadly, there are two schools of thought here, and they are very much evolving over here. Okay, let me try and realistically answer this particular question. We have someone like, say, bank. Let's call that bank HDFC, ICICI, Barclays, any bank that you want to call that bank as. And they have their own data, and they want to understand and get more and more insights in that. Now, banking as a domain can be very generic for retail banking and very specific for investment banking and different parts like asset liability management. It can be very specific and very generic. So to solve specific questions in specific parts of the business, you absolutely need to know and understand the domain. Especially when you need to translate the results from the realms of analytics and statistics to the realms of business. You cannot be showing people p-value, r-value, r-square value, any of that. You want to show people, a karo, wo karo, do this, do that, and you want to be giving recommendations. So definitely domain knowledge plays a part. Now, having said this, I think there are some modern algorithms, disciplines,
methods, techniques, whichever you want to call it,
which are becoming more and more domain agnostic.
So you
really don't need to understand whether this or there are any pinpointed career opportunities for this in India. We are solving a lot of problems. See, I think in India there's a lot of money in the sector, specifically in the banking, you know, BFSI, banking, financial and insurance. I think that sector has a lot of money. A lot of use cases happen over there. Secondly, I would say healthcare, retail. I think these are the sectors where we have a lot of money. So a lot of jobs are getting created over there upfront. And a lot of other sectors are still, you know, lagging behind and they're catching up. So sports, I'm not too sure if I really know of any mainstream companies, and that's my ignorance, but I'm sure that there are a lot of things over here. There is Shani Dev Sharma, and he or she says, what is the criteria for applying as an intern for data analyst? Okay, so intern is always a very tricky position. There are different companies and who have very, very different kind of requirements with respect to internships. There are people who absolutely hire freshers and they're able to take the learning curve on themselves. And there are people who are really looking for someone very, very specific with niche skills, or they require some minimal amount of finishing. One of the best ways to get into a lot of internships is to directly write to hiring managers and founders on LinkedIn, not to go through intern shala, intern theory, and a lot of these internship sites. Not to single out these two, they have fantastic sites, you know, which are helped to source a lot of different talent. But with respect to data sciences, it is very important to write directly to the hiring managers. A very little eyeballing, connecting, social networking will help you identify who really is hiring, where the noise is coming from, where the signal is coming from. And you really need to, like, play with law of large numbers, apply to n number of places, you should be able to get some sort of an output there. Naren again, I'm learning R and Tableau as of now. How important is machine learning for performance analysts? I think it is about, Tableau is always, you know, fantastic with respect to visualizations. There are specific people and jobs and companies who really dig deeper into it. Machine learning is a very generic skill. It can be used, applied, learned using R, Python, or any other library that we have in the market. So yeah, let's go ahead with that. So possibly the, not the best voice question, but yeah, machine learning is something that is the bread and butter, and you really need to pick it up. We have a question from Saad. As a data scientist, job is diversified. How fresh software graduate should follow the final approach to reach there? Can you talk about the milestones here? Fantastic question. So Saad, I think the way for a fresher to get into a data sciences track is one of the toughest. So I would really not, you know, mince with words or make it sound very rosy. It's tough. The way to land a job, to pivot a career into data sciences for a fresher, is essentially to do projects, is to build a portfolio. Then next, I would say, when I say projects, you need to focus on four things. You need to focus on four things. You need to have a project with a supervised learning kind of a use case, unsupervised learning kind of a use case, natural language processing kind of a use case, and time series. I'll repeat: supervised, unsupervised, natural language processing, and some sort of a time series. If you have these four projects in your portfolio and you've done them firsthand, and if you have some sort of a firsthand insight where you can talk to people, I think that's a fantastic point to start conversation with anyone. That's point number one. Second is finding a job directly is, I would say, unless and until you're like super gifted and you're at the extreme right of the curve, you're going to find it tough to break through. One of the best things that you can really do is get into an internship. And there are internships that are always coming up across pan India, and you should aim to get into one of those internships. So that's a good thing. Of course, I think between the whole, I think when I said building the portfolio, before that you really need to have all the skills in place, and it has to be a learning curve that you need to exhaust one and so forth. So the two key milestones for you are get that portfolio project in place and start applying for an internship position. That's a very realistic thing to get started with. Saurabh Prajapati, if a person is not much skilled in statistics and probability, does it affect in becoming a data science, but programming is far good? So I think what I've understood of this question is you're good at programming, but you're not good at statistics and probability. Does it help you or hamper you from becoming a data science professional? So the answer is programming is something that is very much needed. Statistics and probability is something that you have learned and you need to refresh and you need to pick it up. It is not something that you are permanently impaired or you cannot pick it up. I think there are people who pick it up along the way. So it is something that you definitely need to, you know, pick up. You really need to have skills in statistics, and I would say general mathematics. It's not just statistics, but general mathematics. That is something that is very, very important. So I would like to keep this question very binary. You really need to have skills in statistics and probability to make some progress in this particular direction. Okay. So I think I had a good 1 minute where voice really was cracking. I think I'll just keep scrolling up and down. Is my voice audible now? Can I just have a quick yes? Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much. So I'll just take a few more questions and I'll go back. We have 15 minutes over here. I'll just take a few questions in 5 minutes and then I'll go back and we'll have a look at you know, what we are really talking with respect to commit.live and so on and so forth. Okay. So request you to repeat your opinion on importance of business domain in business. Okay. So having an understanding of business domain is something that is absolutely necessary. Let's keep it binary. You have to have it so that you're able to articulate what you have done, your solutions, and you're able to tell things very, very clearly. Fantastic. There is Vimal Athi, and he or she says that I'm preparing big data more than a year. I am very strong at few technologies. I have 4+ years of experience in software development for big data. I have only 1 year of experience, but most of the companies expecting more than 4 years. Okay. Yeah. So I think the question here is very, very relevant. Very relevant. I have 1 year of experience, but overall 4 years of experience, and wherever I'm going, people are asking for 4 years of experience, 5 years of experience, or any years of experience. I think this is absolutely going to happen everywhere, anywhere, whatever skill. So the question that you asked at the end is, so may I lie? So the answer is no. So please don't lie. I think the interviewer who is at the other end probably should be smart enough, and that's why he's interviewing you at the other end. And will be at some point in time be able to figure out all of it. So I would definitely not say. I think one of the best ways to overcome this is to be able to showcase. And I think if the company is hiring based on hiring challenges, so they are truly giving you a problem to solve. If they're giving you a problem to solve, then I think it's not going to be a big challenge. You just have to showcase that you're able to do it. So just keep your eyes open on HackerRank or any other portfolio, you know, platform these days. In general, even if you apply through some of these job portals, they will ask you to solve something. They will give you like a data set, go home, sit for 2 days, come back. So just make sure that I think you're coming very strongly in that particular process rather than overcoating of your experience or anything of that sort. So Saurabh Nikwade, does your course provide hands-on project experience and help with internship? I will show you the product called as commit.live and I'll tell you what exactly, how hands-on we get, so on and so forth. Do you help with internships? So we have career services, which is very much part of the offering. We have career services, which is very much part of the offering. So I'll again show you what I mean by career services and you know, what is the hiring challenge and how people come to the campuses. And there is a team that is dedicated in-house that we call as career services, which is very much kind of, you know, doing this. So I'm just making a note of this, Saurabh Nikwade. And I hope I'm pronouncing your last name accurately. I'm going to answer your question about practice and internship through the demo that we are going to have in like a short while. So again, three questions, and I'm going to stop after these three questions because I'm going to jump back to the quick demo. So you talked about getting internships. How can you find a few, any resources? I think one of the best resources is to get on a lot of job boards. If you're in Mumbai, if you're in Bangalore, if you're in any city in India, which is has a reasonably vibrant meetup scene, events community, or that kind of a scene, make sure that you are at those events and you're talking to enough number of people. Nothing really, I think if you're going to a meetup on a Saturday, what it shows is that A, you could have gone to a mall or some sort of other place on Saturday, but you chose to come to a meetup and you want to listen to a few people, network to a few people, and you're trying to, you know, make some inroads with your career. You're serious about yourself. I think that's a fantastic thing to signal to people. So there are a lot of resources online. Specifically, I would say go to LinkedIn. Go to LinkedIn. You have 1 month free LinkedIn premium. Subscribe to that. Set a calendar invite on your Gmail for 1 month before the whole thing charges you. Get back to the normal thing so you won't get charged. And in that 1 month, use the generous filters that LinkedIn provides you and find people, not jobs, find people who are in position of influence, who are doing really well with respect to data sciences, who have a voice. India, globally, whatever city you belong to, connect with them. Tell them what you want to do. And there will be people who will be able to help you. I think that's the best thing that you can do. Prasad Patil, hi Prasad. I think I know you. Would you please throw some light on the day-to-day responsibilities of data scientists at workplace? Share a few examples with people coming from different core set of skills. And the last question that we have is from Arun. What is the difference between a data analyst and data engineer and data scientist? I mean, practically, how are they different? Great questions. I'll answer all of them. So I'll answer the question that Arun posed first. In the Indian context, roles essentially get mixed up because the Indian employer will typically expect to get a lot more out of the employee than anyone else. They're very, very demanding. If you're doing data science, if you're building models, if you're solving business problems, they will also want you to have some sort of an experience with ops. What I mean by ops is being able to take that model and deploy it to the cloud. To take that model and deploy it to the cloud, to create an endpoint out of it and take it to the cloud. It should be like some sort of a URL which people can play with. If you're able to complete that whole journey, no one just wants you to take it offline, create a model, and give some sort of a code. Kuch to bana ke dikhao, which end product bana ke dikhao, if you're able to productize it. So that's what the Indian employer typically expects. So if you're in the model building, if you're doing data sciences, you really need to be able to talk to the people who are doing data engineering. Someone who's doing a lot of Hadoop, Mongo, Cassandra, data store ho raha hai, stream ho raha hai. बहुत सारी वेलोसिटी के साथ आ रहा है कंसिस्टेंसी रखना है उसका someone who has a deep expertise in database technologies, you should be able to liaise and talk to those guys. So that's what a data engineer would typically be doing. A data scientist will build model and data engineering, the data engineer would essentially be doing a lot of ops. So by ops, I mean not the DevOps. You're not expected to do Ansible, Salt, Pepper, Jenkins, not that kind of a thing, but you should really have understanding of, okay, this is my model in Python. How do I take it to the web? How do I put a Flask kind of a wrapper on top of it? And how do I take it to the web? That is something that I mean by ops. So that's what machine learning ops would typically mean by. So that's the thing. And analyst is again, something of a profile where you have a lot of, customer facing kind of a role. You're talking to a lot of people, those kind of things. Right. And let me quickly come back to the question that Prasad had posed over here. Could you please throw some light on day-to-day responsibilities of data scientists? Okay. So let's take a very, very, specific kind of an example. And this is something, again, a real life example. So we're looking at, again, some sort of a scenario in a bank. And bank is trying to understand its own customers by understanding that whether this customer is going to come back to me in the next 6 months and tell me to change his or her address in the system. So typically globally, these things are done either through a mobile app or a web interface or through walk-in in a branch. This is a very operationally expensive process. Walking in a branch and changing all these things is a very operationally expensive process. So if you can help a bank and help identify that this person is going to come back to you within the next 6 months and ask for a change of branch, then what you can do is you can actually start sending them emails 6 months in advance or 4 months in advance and tell that in case, are you thinking of changing the branch? Why don't you
do it online. You don't need to come to a branch. Now that's the business problem that you're trying to solve. How do you, now what does the data scientist do? The data scientist essentially understands the problem. He says, okay, what kind of data do I have for the customer? I have the demographic data, I have the transaction data, I have some behavioral data, I have a history for last 3 months, for 3 years, or whatever it is. What is an indicator of this? Can I squeeze some behavioral proxy? Can I get a variable out of this? Can I do some engineering on top of it? So that's where that engineer, that data scientist will try and wrap his head around, and he'll talk to a lot of people who are in the branch, who are actually in the business side, and try and understand what some of these things are. He may not get a chance to do all of it, but he may get a chance to do any of it. And that's where I think he's going to try and build some sort of a predictive model. Yes, he's going to switch. No, he's not going to switch the residential address. So those kind of a things. So again, he's going to do a lot of model building, iterating on top of it, talking to the business side, presenting their results, showing that this is what the accuracy is all about, backtesting it on the historical data. So that's what, you know, a lot of these data science professionals will do. I hope I've answered your question. We have 5 minutes over here. What I'm going to do over here is just quickly going back to the, not the presentation, but a very, very quick kind of a demo. So I'm going to show exactly three things. One is I'm going to showcase what commit.live is all about and what are the capabilities that we have in commit.live. Second is what I'm going to talk about is how do people create presence for themselves on the web. And third thing I'm going to show you about is what I mean by hiring challenges and what, you know, GreyAtom does with respect to career services, career placements. Right. So first of all, let's look at commit.live. So this is what we have in commit.live. I hope you're able to see this. So this is a typical interface. I have logged in over here as one of the users, as one of the students, and my name is Anujay. And I have got certain number of points, and I have solved, to get these points, I have solved a certain number of assignments, projects, and puzzles. So what I mean by any of that is, let me just look at what the program typically looks like. So this program has all the content that is basically needed for this particular track. So this person has subscribed to one particular track, and this is all the content. So whether it is a content which is delivered in session, or whether this is some sort of a assignment. So this assignment is very clearly outlined that this is what you need to do. This is the function that you need to write, and this is the input, and this is the output. And you're doing this for solving one larger problem. So what I mean by for doing this for one larger problem is that you're doing this to predict some sort of a house price. The objective of this project is to predict the price of the house. And to predict the price of the house, we are going to solve some 16 to 17 questions. And this is just one of those 16 to 17 questions. And at the end of this particular process, we would actually have solved this particular project. So this is what we call as a very guided approach to having solved a project. These questions are to be basically attempted in a native IDE. What we mean by native IDE is this is a place where you log in and you say, I want to solve this particular thing. You click on this. So this basically starts spinning and it gets the whole interface and you start, you know, solving the problems in this particular place. I think that will just spin up in a moment. So till time, I'll just keep on moving ahead. So this is that particular place. So this has all the content. You have the calendar of when the events are going to be scheduled, when the sessions are scheduled. You can take quiz. Quizzes are triggered by the instructors. Quizzes can be triggered for yourself. The industry videos is again, all the sessions that typically happen where we really need to a lot of, we talk to a lot of people, all the industry people, and their relevant, recent, and most up-to-date kind of insights. Of course, you can connect with us, give us feedback, all those kinds of things. So this was the product that was the app that we saw, that this is the problem that you need to solve and how do you really go about solving some of it. Fantastic. So we have all those things over here. Let me just quickly go back to what I meant by engineering your social presence. So this is the GreyAtom channel. So this GreyAtom channel is based on Medium. Medium is a very popular site. And these are the blogs that are written by students. So Sudarshan Asai Thambi is a student. Mohammed is a student. Sudarshan is a student. Sahil is a student. Everyone, Sagar is a student. So what they do is they write these blogs over here. And what happens is, this is a fairly popular channel where people come on this particular site and they retweet. So what are the outcomes of some of these is that you can start conversation with anyone. Ye dekh bhai, ye maine char blog likha hai. These are the four blogs that I have written and you can have a conversation. There have been some publications like Packet Publication, which is a technical publication house. They have come to us and have said, we want people to write for us. Can you help us with some sort of writers? So they find a lot of, you know, writers over here. And these are paid opportunities, by the way. You get a lot of visibility. You find some voice which you're able to express in the market. So this is commit.live. This is GreyAtom. And the last thing that I really want to show for today is what I meant by hiring challenges and opportunities. So I'm going to actually open up my email box and I'm going to show you a conversation that we're having with a company. And this is just indicative. We are having conversations with multiple companies. There are people who have hired from us, Flexi Loans, HDFC Life, the data team, lots of other people. So I'm going to open this particular mail. I hope you're able to see this. So this is a conversation between our team and Fractal Analytics. And don't get me wrong, I'm not quoting anyone out of context. This is just a conversation. And this is under process. People are actually looking at hiring some of our people. And they conducted a hiring challenge. There was a problem that was out there. So this was a hackathon problem. This got conducted. And that's how the whole thing essentially, you know, went through. So this is what we mean truly by a hiring kind of a challenge. So there is a career placements team that is very much in place, whose whole job is to, you know, find more and more of these opportunities for the students and keep on supplying and pumping them in the ecosystem. I guess we have run out of time. I still see honestly a few questions that I have to answer. So here is what I'm going to do. I am going to share one email address over here, and I have maybe another couple of minutes and I'm going to take maybe a few questions. academics@greyatom.com. Please feel free to reach out to us. We'll be more than happy to answer a lot of these questions, even offline, and continue to move ahead. If you go to the website, you will find the phone number. You should, if you have any questions, just reach out to that number, and we'll be again very happy to answer some of this. I'm going to stop the screen share. You'll now be able to see me, and I'm going to extend this conversation to all the questions that you have. But let's see. I think there is again a question from Saurabh Prajapati. Yeah, Saurabh Prajapati says, what kind of data should I practice? Because financial, e-commerce, I mean, which one is the best that gives me deep practice with complexity? So complexity is function of maybe a couple of things. One is, I think, what kind of problem you are trying to solve. So you can be solving one of the toughest problems with the simplest data set. And there's nothing called as a simple or simplest data set. But I think a very good way to approach and to look at data sets and is basically about, I think, placing more weight on problem statements. What are the problems that you're really trying to solve? And then you can solve them with even the simplest data sets and the toughest data sets. There is a lot of merit in using industry data sets. So industry data sets are also available openly. There are Amazon data sets, IMDb data sets, Netflix data sets, which are available openly. And where a lot of work has already been done by a lot of people all across the globe. So I would say it is very important that you take any of it, but just go to the depth of that particular problem statements, bring out innovation, bring out the depth of the algorithm, make sure that you have a very clear, complete understanding of what you're doing. I think that is more important rather than just a blanket choice of what data set is all about. Yeah. Fair enough. I think there is a private question. I'll take that privately and answer it. There's one more question from Saad. From what I see, this isn't something a fresher should opt for. I am biased here. Am I biased here? Shouldn't it be better off going with, say, being a DBA first, work for a few months, and then come back, upgrade yourself with this? So I'm being very categorical and binary that I think the road for a fresher is a tougher road. It's not an impossible road. It's a tougher road. And it is very important to get onto anything with very clear and realistic set of expectations. आई थिंक इफ एनीवन सेज यार एक कोर्स कर लो या कोई भी कोर्स कर लो दुनिया में और तुमको हो जाए तो ऐसा नहीं होता. आई थिंक दिस इज टफ टफ फ्रॉम अ मार्केट सिनेरियो पर्सपेक्टिव. इफ यू आर अ फ्रेशर आई थिंक यू नीड टू फाइट मोर बैटल्स देन एनीवन एल्स. सो गिवन दैट फैक्ट वुड आई प्रिस्क्राइब दैट यू डू समथिंग एल्स एंड यू नो कम बैक ओवर हियर. I would say there are like, you know, being a data science professional, I think it encompasses a few things. One is, I think you have to develop competencies as a general programmer. That itself opens up multiple doors for you in data, in software engineering, so on and so forth. So that's one road ahead, one way ahead. So again, I think the prescribed route is, again, get strong portfolio projects. Of course, develop competencies. If you're a fresher, you'll be asked more and more in detail. I think there are people who go for interviews and then build very deeply on mathematics and everything. It will be expected of you. It's going to be tough. It's not impossible. So again, I would stay with the same prescription. Strong portfolio, stronger preparation, and start off as an intern because that's an easier entry point and you'll be able to grow from there really, really faster. So Saad, with respect to are you biased, are you not biased? I would really leave it up to you. Depending on what part of the globe you are, you would be in the best position to take this call locally, and depending on what is your catchment area with respect to the environment. Fantastic. So I think if we are on 9495, I'll take the last question. We have it from Aditya. I have completed the Udacity's machine learning nano degree course. In that, I have worked on various projects that included deep learning, supervised learning, unsupervised NLP. Also, I have an year experience in software development. How can I approach the companies to get a job? And should I go for an internship in data science or should I apply for a job now? Fantastic question. Udacity is one of the fantastic resources to pick up a lot of stuff. With Udacity, I think it is not whether you have completed the program or you have not completed the program. You have completed the project or you have not completed the project. There is no real measure of completeness of a project. What I would really kind of say is that if you've done, and I have honestly seen that program that we have on Udacity, I think it's a very rewarding, compelling, nice program. I think how much you have, done justice to it. So let me just take a minute over here. So we at GreyAtom are very clear that learning is in part something that an instructor can help you. Instructor can help you from a remote location. You see some self-paced videos and everything. The majority of learning, 25% of the learning will happen when an instructor is going to help you. 25% of the learning is going to happen when the instructor will help you across any channel. 60% of your learning is going to happen when you work on projects. 60% of the learning will happen when you work on projects in teams. When you work on projects in teams. And that is a dynamic that is very difficult to kind of recreate in some of the environments that maybe Udacity is able to provide. I think they have an excellent mentor network and a lot of valuable feedback I'm sure must be flowing on from there. But I think where learning is truly going to happen is when you start doing stuff on your own, and there are going to be three other people who are in your team and they're going to do the same stuff and you all are going to get stuck. And then you're going to find a way to get out of it. You're going to break through out of it. And that's what is going to give you a lot of confidence. And that will take you places and want to do more and more stuff. So I think having that blanket thing where I have done this or I have not done this probably is not the best way to look at it. I personally believe, I think it's a good program. I'm sure you've done a great amount of justice to it. So based on all of that, how should I approach the companies to get a job? So here is the good news. I think there are tons of jobs in machine learning. There are tons of jobs in data sciences. What you probably need to pick up from a skills perspective and what may not have been covered in the machine learning nano degree program is something that you want to pick up on the AWS side or the deployment side or productionizing the ML side. And you might want to develop some depth over there and you're able to kind of, communicate to a lot of people. I think once that skill is also in place and you have a portfolio that you can show. So let me tell you what I mean by portfolio that you can show. Are you guys able to see the screen? No, right? Yeah, let me, are you able to see the screen now? Fantastic. So this is one particular person. His name is Bijit Deka, and he has a presence on GitHub, and that's his portfolio. And he has some 99 repositories. He's worked on multiple projects. So probably he's not showcasing all of them to the people he wants to talk to, but he's showcasing only two or three of them. Now that's presence. Now he's able to start conversation with absolutely anyone and say, this is what I've done, that is what I've done. And there are like 250 students from GreyAtom who exactly have a very strong presence. They have presence on GitHub. They have presence on Medium. They have something that you have earned on this particular thing. And they are able to have conversations. They have solved hiring challenges. They have solved hackathons. So let me just pull up something again. So this is again, there was an event called a Startup Bootcamp in Mumbai. So this was conducted straight hackathon, which lasted for close to 2.5 days. So there's someone who won this particular event, and his name is Nikhil Prasad. And Nikhil Prasad is also a student of GreyAtom. So he won this particular thing. I'll tell you a very interesting fact over here. This person who won the hackathon, the Startup Bootcamp hackathon, he won a cool 1.5 lakh rupees. He had just started his data science journey. It was probably somewhere midway. So the good thing is that, you know, it's how much you apply, how much you're able to just apply work. It is not about how many algorithms you know. It is how much depth you have in any algorithm that you have. It is all about depth. So that's the thing over here. So coming back to the question that we had from Aditya, you've done your Udacity thing. Great, fantastic. You have some skills. I would say up your question, up your skills on AWS, on the productionizing the thing. And how should I start approaching companies? Again, I would say LinkedIn is probably a great medium. There are tons of jobs. I think discovery of the job is not a problem. There are tons of these lists, AngelList, LinkedIn, tons of these available. But just make sure you have the right presence. When you're reaching out to people, make sure you have something to show, your portfolio, your medium presence, and you're able to have conversations. And that's really what is going to get people interested. Write the mails to hiring managers. I think that's again the same recipe. Probably that's the way to go ahead. Fantastic. So Aditya, I think you have a lot to offer, and there are a lot of things. Very, very happy to answer a lot of these offline. We're already at 9:10, probably overshot the question. Fantastic. Oh, nice. Aditya, let's connect offline and we can take it from there. Fantastic. Guys, once again, I will share an email address. academics@greyatom.com. Please feel free to write to this particular email address. You can also go to our website, and on the website you will find something called as you can schedule a counseling session. So I'll just share that link also here. So you can schedule that counseling session and you can reach out to us over there. So you can book a slot, and that will give you a one-on-one kind of a slot with one of us, or you know, any one of us, someone who's really competent and probably be able to help you through this. So that's the link for that. So please, you know, click here and schedule the session, and we should be able to take it from there on. Thank you so much. I hope it was really a useful session. I would love to hear back on this particular thing. Most of you most likely will get some sort of a feedback form that, you know, will help us understand how the session went, and would be able to help you even better in the sessions going forward. Thank you so much for the time. Sorry for extending this by 12 minutes, a few questions that popped up, but yeah. Would be more than happy to answer them offline. Thank you once again.